Hello, I just wanted to show a little of the progress that I've made towards the autonomous quadcopter control project. Just using my 2D physics test bed here, and you can see what the quadcopter is doing there is position hold. It's trying to stay on that yellow dot as much as it can. And the reason it's sort of wobbling around quite a bit, at least compared to my last video in which it was able to just go there quickly and directly and with no overshoot or anything. The reason it's wobbling around is because I've now taken away all of the cheating things that I was doing. So before I was just simply, if I wanted to find the position, I'd use get position. The angle would I would just get that by using get angle. But that's cheating. You can't do that in the real world. So in the real world, the inputs that I I'm expecting to be able to use GPS coordinates, which are not exact and they tend to move around a little bit. And the other input will be from accelerometer and gyroscope. So the first thing I did was to adjust it a little bit so that when I'm flying it myself, it feels a little bit more like the real thing. So I just made it so that you couldn't snap the well, it's still a bit snappy, but it's not as bad as it was. You can't snap from side to side by rolling it super quickly like that anymore. So that was the first thing. And once I got that sorted, I made a sort of a fake accelerometer input. So I'm using the change in velocity from the box 2D body to generate some accelerometer pseudo, well, not really pseudo, they're actually real, but I'm generating the inputs that I would expect to get here. So if I move the body here left and right, you can see the red line on the left. That would be the horizontal acceleration change. And if I move it up and down, you'll see the green line. So that's the vertical acceleration change. And this is the acceleration in the local coordinate frame of the quadcopter. So if I drop it on its side, we'll actually see the red line moving more from that. So that's the kind of input that the kind of readings you would expect to get from an accelerometer in real life. The other input that I'm using, which I'm not really showing anywhere here, is the current angle of the body. So I'm just using get angle to do that still, but I'm putting in some error, and I'm also adding some error into these accelerometer readings so that they're not really perfect. But I'm not really assuming that getting the angle will be a problem because that is something that has been solved by the flight controllers already quite well done. So I don't think that will be an issue. Anyway, so onto the main story, which is the GPS. And what I've done, you can see up here I have some numbers. GPS error is 3. So I'm taking the position and I'm generating some random locations around it within a range of 3 meters away to be my fake or my test GPS values. And I'm doing that using Gaussian noise, which is a little bit like this. Doesn't look like it has too much of a form up close, but if you zoom out a bit, you'll see that even though the overall range is kind of in a square, the values that you get tend to be more frequently closer to the true answer. So at the moment, this is just generating values around the 0, 0 point, so it's nothing to do with the quadcopter like that. But if we turn on the actual values that I'm using to be shown, this is the kind of results we're getting. Just ignore the yellow dot for now. But if I pause this, the white dots are the readings that we are getting from the GPS. and they're coming in at a rate of 5 hertz. And the green dot is the average of, it's not really the average, but it's a weighted average, so it weights the most recent one higher than the others. So you can kind of see that if I wait till the next one comes in. Oh, that's not a very good one. Hang on, let's get another one. There. So when the next one comes in, we'll see that we moved from our old one. This is the new reading we got. We're only going halfway towards the new reading. So over a period of time, it tends to keep this value closer to the actual value in the actual location. So yeah, that's what those dots are. So you can see that what I'm doing here is, this would be a really, really bad GPS in real life. It's bouncing around within a range of 6 meters from one side to the other, which is not really characteristic of how GPS values tend to come in. They seem to usually be more, they don't change too quickly, if you're not moving, that is, of course. So this is really bad noise, which is okay, because I'm trying to make the best of a bad situation. All right. Now I'll turn on the final display, which was this purple line here, and that is where the quadcopter thinks it is. And if I just slow this down a bit, you can see that it's sort of heading towards the most recent GPS position that it got, or the most recent smoothed GPS position. But in actual fact, that's not all it's doing. Because if I just unpause it for a second, if I grab hold of the quadcopter and I yank it quickly up in one direction here, and I paused there as well, so you'll see the obviously the accelerometer's going off, and you'll see that the position that it thinks it's at has also followed that quickly, even though I did that in a fraction of a second. And we don't have any good GPS readings for this new location yet. So the method that I'm using to do this is called Kalman filtering, and it's a pretty cool technique. And I've been putting off doing this for a long time because I just couldn't really wrap my head around how it worked. And finally, one video that I watched, and also a couple of web pages that I read through, and finding also a library to help me deal with matrices easily, finally helped me to break through this mental block I had with getting this algorithm worked out. So anyway, what the algorithm does is it takes multiple sets of data, or sensor data usually, so it's usually called sensor fusion, in that it takes, for example, we have accelerometer here and GPS, and it tries to make sense of those in the best way possible. So you can see as we move along here, we've detected this bounce coming from the accelerometer, but the most recent GPS location we have is here. And as we move along a little bit further, we'll see that if we were only using accelerometer data, the quadcopter would still think it's here, because that's the only thing it knows from the accelerometer, because now the quadcopter is not moving anymore. However, the GPS data is still with us, and we can adjust better to where we are. So it's the best of both worlds. You have the very fast moving data that has no absolute positioning, that's the accelerometer, and you have slow moving and inaccurate data that does have absolute positioning, which is a GPS, and it merges those together in a very sensible way. And it wasn't really that hard I knew that I had to get it done. So I just sat down and finally tried to figure it out. So once you get to that point, things start to happen. So what we're trying to do with this is, if I click here, this is going to be the point that I'm trying to get this to move to, And I'm going to have to turn it up the right way to do that. There we go. Now, if I set the algorithm to start auto control, you'll see that in stark contrast to the way it was moving before, which was very zippy and sprightly, it was just flying straight there immediately. Now we have to do things much, much slower, because mainly because the information that we're getting from the GPS, we can't use any one of these points, that any one of these readings that we're getting. We have to sort of wait, we have to give it a little time and use the average of them. So for that reason, we can't move too quickly when we're trying to adjust. So if I change the set point over here, you'll see that it just moves along there at a pretty leisurely pace, and it will in most cases overshoot a little bit instead of stopping quite nicely as it did before. But given that we have an error range of 6 meters from one side to the other on the position readings we're getting, I think it's not too bad. And I've made it adapt to how far away it is from the goal. So if I make the goal a bit further away, it will actually move faster, at least during the central part of the journey. So around about here, it should be as fast as it's going to get. And then it should slow down as it gets closer to where it's going. So it's a bit sluggish, but from what I've seen of quadcopter videos doing position hold and like waypoint following and return to home and that kind of stuff, they don't really zip around at a high rate of speed or anything very often. This is, in fact, it kind of looks like this most of the time. Oh yes, and so the yellow line here is just the estimated velocity, that's all. And one other very important thing that I had to figure out how to do was how to know what throttle, how much throttle would be needed to hover. So in this case, we're estimating that we need a hover throttle of about 0.42. So this is just from 0 to 1 at the bottom, from the bottom to the top. And this is done by applying some throttle and measuring the acceleration that caused. So force equals mass times acceleration. So you could also say that mass equals force divided by acceleration. So we can't do that in one time step either. We have to spend sort of at least, you know, a second or two applying some force and measuring the acceleration that we got to estimate the mass of the quadcopter. And this is done because you need to, well, you could measure the mass of it and try and, you know, set the value that you need to hover the throttle. But in real life, when a human's flying it, that's not what you do. You apply some throttle, look at what happens, and then, you know, calculate in your brain where the throttle point is that's going to be a constant hover throttle. So I wanted to simulate that kind of behavior instead of, you know, explicitly measuring how much does the thing weigh and how much throttle do we need, because you need to adapt on the fly, like during a flight, to different things. Like, the main one is battery, I guess. So you can see I also have a value here for battery, which is set at 1 at the moment. So that's, we could say that's like a full battery. So when you do a certain amount of throttle, you get a certain amount of, you get the result you expect. Now I can reduce that. If I hit a key on my keyboard here, I can reduce that so that the power that we're getting from the motors is cut to, say, 60%. And you'll see it dip down quite a bit. But almost immediately you'll see that it adapts to that, and instead of estimating that the hover throttle was 0.4 as we had just before, now it's 0.6 to 0.7-ish. And if I drop it down a little bit more, we get to a point where it can't actually hold itself up. Actually, I think one more we need to go down. So now we're at a severe low battery state, and it's putting the throttle right up to full, and it's not getting anything out of it. So yeah, that's what's happening here. And if I just quickly turn the battery power up to normal again, we'll see that it overreacts, but almost immediately it comes back to putting the throttle down to about 40%. So that was another problem that I had put off trying to solve for a long time as well. And I figured out how to do that. So I'm not sure how all the stuff is happening in the real quadcopter GPS position hold tricky little gadgets that are out there. But this is what I'm hoping to try with mine. And given that all of the inputs that I'm using here can realistically be used in a real situation, and that the amount of errors that I'm putting in and so on, I think are reasonable. Of course, there's no wind in this situation. That's the only thing I don't really have simulated. And if I turn the wind on, like I had in my previous video, it all turns to shit. So that's one thing I still need to try and do before I take it out in the real world. But anyway, at this stage, this is what it's looking like, and this video is about 5 times as long as I intended it to be, so I think I'll just leave it there.